sometimes we tend to put everything in one controller and then we discover that something is not working. So we try to understand what is this, how to use it. Especially it is important when you are migrating from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, because in Drupal 7 controller is not always a distinct entity, but in Drupal 8 it is there by default, but is that one we think we can name it controller or not. If you can go to 2016, there is a presentation in Montreal regarding the object-oriented style used in Drupal 8, and this presentation is a logical continuation. So, controllers, as I told, is the same name but meaning different things in different environments. We know Gang of Four that 23 patterns, design patterns, we are trying to use, but then we know that exist such things like grasps, grasp and solid. What are these? Why those two? And where controllers belong? To every one of them, or is just something in Gang of Four list? But what is this? So the main difference is that Gang of Four are patterns that we can use for recurring problems. So you see a pattern here, right? The same fly, butterfly, start here, end here, and actually this part is one pattern, but you can call this part also a pattern and this one also, because only colors are different. Grasp and solid are principles, so they're a little bit a higher level than design patterns. So those are true in general, let's say. You have to remember them when you have troubles understanding how to do things. To understand better, we have the main object-oriented principles. Those are hierarchy, abstraction, modularity, encapsulation. So encapsulation, when you try to hide your logic inside a class. Modularity, when there are principles of high cohesion and loosely coupling. Inheritance and aggregation, a part of hierarchy. And usually we are talking encapsulation and modularity when we are doing some classes, and that is not exactly right, because this is a real, real top level in object-oriented programming, and it was first done in 91. And after that, a lot of different principles and laws and design patterns appeared according to the list. On the second level, there are principles. And here we have solid, grasp, and law of Demeter principles. Maybe you know solid and grasp, but law of Demeter is telling that class has to know what he is doing, his dependencies, but class should not know anything else about the system. So it's kind of a single entity. And only after that, already Gang of Four, 24 principles, but we have already start using practically in our work. But regarding this 23, we have another 72 heuristic principles, and is not principle, is heuristics method or way to do a class. So when you are working practically, doing some functionality inside the class, you have to use Gang of Four and heuristics, these principles, but remember that you have to respect these two inside levels, but a higher level, and those are actually a must. Just to remember you, what is grasp principle, so is a general responsibility principle, grasp solid, you see the first capital letters explain what it is, single responsibility, open for extension, closed for modification when we are talking about class or method. One interface shall be enough for a client, that is substitution principle, interface segregation, dependency inversion. Those are principles like we are learning them sometimes in the university, and I have a couple of cases when during our presentation people came and told, "Oh, I remember we learned something at the university, but now I see that we can use it in practical world." And if you are really a person of 47-year-old, like in the previous slide, maybe you are using those principles, but name those principles differently. So you know this one. Don't repeat yourself. His principle, right? Keep things simple, stupid, that's good. Favorite composition of the inheritance is a couple of two. This Hollywood principle is very easy to remember. Don't call us, we will call you. So your class should wait. Somebody will need this class. She should not be active initiating something per se, because usually initiating and events are part of front end. You are back end, so you have to sit and wait. Then somebody will call you and you will start reacting. Hollywood principle is quite a good principle to follow. And this is a little bit verbose slide, but this is the first time when in GRASP, General Responsibility Assignment Software Patterns, finally we see controller here. So is a principle. Controller is a principle. But we see controller also is in Gang of Four. There are no controller per se named in Heuristic 72, but in Gang of Four, we have them. But this is the main part that will explain you what is a controller. I will talk more about controller and responsibility. Because if you look on the description of this GRASP principles, you see that everywhere there is this word, responsibility, right? Who is responsible for creation? Who will fulfill or collect the information? Who will assign responsibility for handling a system event? Who assign responsibility when coupling remains low? Everywhere is this word, responsibility. So let's talk about it. What is responsibility? Is what an object or class is doing or knowing means. You create an object doing a calculation, you initiate an action or controlling activities in other objects, but first you receive a request from somewhere. You know about encapsulated data because they are going through you when you delegate responsibility to some specialized class, and the controller is holding this state, he knows what comes from where it's gone, and which is that state. This is knowing. Reference to other objects, because he has to know where to address the coming request, how to get and calculate something. So as such, this is so-called responsibility-driven design in contrast to what we hear, data-driven design. So MVC, model view controller, is more about data-driven design, because then you start thinking about project inside MVC, you start thinking about model, which fields in the database would be there, how different operations would be done, and then slowly come from that side in grasp, and then you want to use properly controller, things are done a little bit different, you have to think about responsibility. Then something happened in the system. And usually this is happened through UI. Client opened URL in browser, and there is an event there. Client click on the form, click on the link, is doing something, and that reaction will go to controller, and controller sometimes he will do something as a response, but usually, and the recommended way is when controller simply delegate the action that needs as a response to that event to some other specialized classes, and just retain the state of that button on the front end, or that link that was clicked, from where it came, and so on and so on. So this part is important to understand, and this part is a responsibility-driven design. But not means data-driven design is bad, but means you have to include RDD in the framework you are using, even that framework normally is MVC framework. So controller delegate and knows. But usually we try to not delegate to single controller too much responsibility. It means in this case controller will become bloated, and this is already anti-partisan. He has to delegate it to other objects and do not do too much work himself. And when you're using model view controller, your controller, according to responsibility, he has to know where the model is, he has to know which events he is reacting, and how to use the model in this case. So the main two controllers are facade controllers and use case controller. Facade is usually a single controller in a small Drupal model, for example. And actually Drupal itself, the interface is a facade controller. So he's responding to the system events. And we are using facade controller when not too many events to control appear are in the system. For example, those usual events in Drupal are covered by the core, so you don't care about them. You are doing your own model, and you are looking what kind of events are in your own model. If there are not too much of them, facade controller is a good choice. Facade is a Django 4 pattern, so look there and use it. Use case controller is a thing that we switch to from facade controller when facade controller starts having high coupling already. He starts depending of, there is appear too much dependency of other classes. There are some functionality inside your controller that make it unusable if some class is not working properly or fail or something. So single responsibility principles became fuzzy in this case. So it's a time to switch. And I know Nick has a rule of thumb how many methods has to be in the controller when it's time already to create a new one. So he will talk about this. But so there is a significant number of events, maybe more than but seven. You know, people like this number seven. So until seven, you're okay. If more than seven, it's time to create another controller. But this state of the current scenario is a good way to hold it in your controller. This is a place where the state is remembered and used when events are coming in. This part has to be remembered and used. So it's a little bit about MVC. MVC is kind of linear. You see, controller in the MVC, user is seeing the view, is using the controller. Controller reacts to model, model update the view, and user is seeing it. So every time with multiple events, you are kind of holding the same pattern, the same circle, and sometimes became difficult because your controller became bloated, but you are using the single model, things like that. And in Grasp is a little bit different. And so look at this part. Every MVC controller is still kind of Grasp controller because it is, for example, facade controller is can be model view controller. But our use case controllers are not MVC, they are Grasp controllers. Frankly speaking, I was a little bit puzzled when I saw this first time, but then I understand that according to business logics and the use case for a specific event, you can have your own MVC part of the program that are completely independent of other events and other MVC. So you're multiplying controllers and multiplying models, maybe, or hold your models in different classes, but multiple controllers will know where to address when the specific events come. So for Grasp, we usually are using this type of language. Boundary objects are abstraction of the interface. So you have some operations that have to be done. Users enter in the point of sale, is reading the card, or is pressing print, or something like that. So there are flow of operations. Entity objects are application independent, means those entity objects are responding to specific events, and control objects are those controllers. And this is a controller pattern. So UI receivers are not handlers, but forms, widgets, view. This is a presentation layer. So then you press the button on the form, it's not going directly to controller. There are receivers somewhere. It is included already in your framework, or you're writing it itself, and this receiver already will interact with the controller. And here come the part that is a little bit fuzzy for all the developers, because actually, in Grasp terms, all of these are controllers. Handler is handling the event, right? This is a controller, controller itself. And we see classes called manager, coordinator, service, helper. Those are all class names for controller. So when you see something like this in the class name, look closer, and this handler is really a controller. Maybe not that facade controller, but one of the underlying controllers that will handle a specific flow, a specific use case.
Nice question. I was wondering if you were talking about Drupal, because a lot of classes get named controller, handler, manager, or if you're talking about object-oriented design.
It is more about object-oriented design, but in Drupal, yeah. Handlers are controllers when you are using inside your
inside your own development, for example.
Your own development, yeah.
Because this means
your own model.
They are like, it is always, there are like controllers and controllers, handlers. This naming, it is not strict, but it is some rule of thumb. And when you see some name, okay, this is a controller.
Yeah,
and
so we will go now to the NIC area, but finally, you see a lot of example like this. Yeah, this is not a Drupal, this is from the .NET something, but there is user interface. This user interface is interacting with the domain objects, his own class, and you see that it's kind of working. So you can tell this is a controller if you don't know exactly what we talk till this moment, right? Because there is an interaction there is an event, and this event is directed to the specific class, and this is a controller. Actually, no. If you're looking properly, then things has to be done this way. This is a real grasp, and this is the way when we are using controller, and try to use it specifically this way, and then you can create a maintainable system. Page up, page down. And now it's a little bit closer to Drupal. Nick will continue. Thank you. Yeah, some graphics
okay.
Disappeared
in
the full screen.
We didn't use full screen before because it was some bugs and not all the pictures were shown. And now it is like, it is maybe...
All images.
All images are visible. Does it...
Yeah, it's somewhere.
Okay. I don't see the light. Yes, it's here. Okay, so this is an example from a real Drupal module. This module is DB maintenance. It is on site Drupal.org, and it is one of few modules which were in production state. That means not dev, not anything, but in real production state from day one of Drupal 8, when Drupal 8 modules were appeared like to be allowed in production state. This module was there from day one. And usually when we are talking from migration of module from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, in fact, that means almost to rewrite it completely. But there is a more convenient way, at least for us, to transfer it to Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, and also use an object-oriented approach. All this stuff like adapters, controllers, classes, etc. What we did. So this module is simple enough. You can find it on Drupal.org, and it is just a presentation what is inside. In Drupal 7, we have a picture of Drupal 7. In Drupal 8, we have some pieces like controller, form, config, which appear in Drupal 8. What we did with Drupal 7 module, we put all stuff which is module specific, into separate subfolder module here and here. After that, when you put it to object-oriented stuff, and there will be many controllers I'll show you them later. We just moved this module folder to Drupal 8 shape of module, and I adjusted it a bit. And done, it works. So let us continue with this. Yes. So the very simple class config handler. If we see handler, that means controller. And because it handles just a configuration, it is use case controller. So the use case of handling all configuration, we put into separate controller. And if we see Drupal 7, if we see Drupal 7 class scheme and Drupal 8 class diagram, they are the same, or almost the same. That means the same method, the same stuff. And we just calling this message from our mainstream as it was before in Drupal 7. Now we do the same in Drupal 8. But when we'll see the code which is inside, it is completely different. Because config handler implementation, this use case handler, the method how to get or set this values in Drupal 7, it is regular variable get or variable set. Is it visible pieces of code or not very good? I suppose that even if it is not very good, it is sufficient, because it is here I placed very, very simple pieces. So in Drupal 7, it is variable get, variable set. In Drupal 8, it is like Drupal config, etc. But all these calls are encapsulated into this config handler, into this controller backend class, which for all main execution stream of module, it is the same. So here are two advantages. First, we don't need to rewrite every piece of module to replace this Drupal 7 stuff to Drupal 8 stuff. And another advantage, when we have all these calls in one place, we rewrite it in one place. We are not jumping between different pieces of code. It is everything here, and it is quite similar. Here, all variable get, variable set. Here is like a Drupal config, and we have all here. So what we have here, we encapsulated into this controller simple use case. For now, use case is configuration, and we smoothly move this piece of functionality from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8. Now, a bit more complex example. Oh, by the way, if you see here, in Drupal 7, we have default values. In Drupal 8, we have not default values there because they are in YAML file, but okay. It doesn't matter because anyway, we have the same class diagram, and we have the class and this piece of functionality, this use case of handling configuration, is the same for mainstream of module execution. So we encapsulated all these differences, and inside the mainstream of module, of mainstream of execution, we have no differences, because they are all encapsulated inside this controller, inside this handler. Now a bit more complex piece, which illustrated the same principle. We encapsulate some DP handling pieces into separate set of classes as well. Why these DB handling pieces, we write separate classes but not use the main library for handling a database, because main library is handling database select, insert, update, delete. And here are very specialized commands which are server specific and which are not data handling. It is some maintenance of like a packing database and all this stuff. So commands are quite different, and we handle them the same. This module, it handles MySQL server and PostgreSQL server. And initial version of module was always if MySQL do such and such, if PostgreSQL do such and such. And these pieces of code were scattered everywhere in the module. So what's to do? First, to collect all these pieces, all common calls, behind the same DB, one DB handler. Handler means also controller. This use case controller, it is also use case. It handles some special database calls, which are not select, insert, update, delete, but service database calls. And this is DB handler, which handles it. So now let us see. Yes, for example, the piece like list tables, which are in the database. This is call from mainstream, and this call, it doesn't know even whom is it talking to. Is it MySQL handling classes or MS SQL handling classes? We just get handler, some handler, we don't know what, we just know that it produces list tables. And after that, do this list tables. So main execution stream of module, it takes some object, he doesn't know who is this, but he does know that it supports the contract, which interface is the contract that it can provide these list tables. So we have here in this piece of DB handler just optimized tables and list tables. We put some common interface which has these two methods, and after that we created two type of objects. MySQL DB handler, which handles this for MySQL, and PGSQL handler, which handles this for PostgreSQL. So now let us imagine that we need to add Oracle or MS SQL or something else, some other SQL SQL server. We don't need to rewrite whole module and whole execution cycle. We need just to add one more handler, which supports this interface, which follows this interface. After that, all other mainstream will be the same. So, yes. When we get this DB server handler, so controller, use case controller, if DB driver in Drupal configuration is MySQL, we provide a new MySQL handler. If PGSQL, PostgreSQL handler. If it would be, for example, MSSQL, MSSQL handler. So if we don't have it, just unsupported DB server type, exception so far. So what we have? We just put some particular controller, we wrap it, and we provide this controller to main execution stream of module via interface. And after that, main workflow, it doesn't know whom is it talking to particularly. That's why this loose coupling, that means that mainstream is unchanged. When you need to add something, you can, to add some other server, you just need to write some small one class and done. And all starts working with this.
Please note the second line, D7 and D8. So this is the code in D7 and in D8. Is the same?
Yeah, it is no difference. It is just we placed copy from D7, put to D8, it just works immediately because it is properly encapsulated. So that means not just programming, but it is programming with fun, comfortable, easy, and it just works. And by the way, one more piece here. It is some small function cast which returns DB server handler interface. This small function, it is just some PHP trick which allows tag hinting, this new feature which started with PHP 5 and after that moved to PHP 7, to check the type during the execution. And sometimes it is very handy because if we put something wrong, it will tell us, okay, this type is not DB handler interface, it is something else. And it is much more specific that some error appeared somewhere. Okay, and after that try to find where and what. Here it explains everything. So if it is DB handler interface, it should run smoothly. If it is not DB handler interface, but some other class, we will be notified immediately. Yes?
Is that to avoid using an instance of to make this more explicit?
Yes, because if we will take, for example, C sharp or Java, the function here will be not public static function, but it will be like public static DB handler interface function such and such.
Yes.
So in C++, C#, Java, here we can return type value and we can explain it here. But here, because in PHP, because we cannot do it, but we can do this type in function parameters. That's why we put it into function parameters and we return not just object, but put it through cast. After that, we verify the type and we return type parameter. Or we will be immediately notified that something goes wrong and particular where it goes wrong.
Yeah, okay, maybe after that. You could probably also use instance of, but the difference is you would then have to throw the error yourself.
Yeah, yeah.
This way PHP creates and throws the error for you.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too. I get it.
Yeah.
So I know in 7.2 you can specify a return type
as well.
They already did because I checked. I always looking for it because I do also a lot of programming in .NET and I really was missing it.
Yeah, it's a really recent edition. I think it's 7.2, it might have been 7.1.
Oh, 7.2. Yeah. Because I checked pure 7, but maybe in 7.2. Okay, I'll definitely double check because anyway, this is a good workaround, but anyway, it is workaround. It is explicit, it would be much nicer. Because now what I see is that PHP becomes closer and closer to C#. Just remove $ before variable, replace arrow to dot and you have C# and vice versa.
Actually, the method to create and migrate from D7 to D8 is take a model, rewrite it in the object-oriented style, do the proper config, and then copy and paste the business logic. Copy and paste works, and it worked nicely here. That was We were surprised that everything started working instantly, just copy and paste every single class, except because there is info, here is YAML file, the only difference.
Yes, and also there is one advantage of this gradually transferring D7 to D8, first to rewrite it to object-oriented style. Why? Because when we rewriting just D7 module in regular way to D8 module, we have just a big canyon to jump through because it doesn't work when we start to rewrite it. But when we start to rewrite D7 module to object-oriented style, we rewrite it gradually. So on every stage of rewriting, we can check that module still works. If it doesn't work, return back and see what happened. because this PSR 0, PSR 4, it is all available as separate modules in Drupal 7. And when it has been rewritten to complete object-oriented style with these adapters, controllers, etc., after that we have something which is much more stable in time, because we use not just a Drupal 7 notation or Drupal 8 notation, we use PHP natural object-oriented notation, which is not going to change a lot of from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, Drupal 9, etc. That's why it is convenient we gradually rewrite the module into object-oriented style, and we always ensure that it does work. When it is completely rewritten, by the way, it was the same with this module. DB maintenance 7.1 line, it was regular D7, and 7.2, it is object-oriented. After that, we just grabbed everything, put it into 8 shape, and we have Drupal 8.1.
That's why it was one of the first.
Yeah, because of this simple approach. So, not only programming, but programming comfortably and with fun. Okay, and thank you. And question, please, another question.
Might be a stupid question, but how do so-called factory classes fall into the controller class category? Are they a controller? Are they not? Mm-hmm. If so, or if not, then why?
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay, I see. Because it was factory classes you saw. Maybe it'll be for another presentation after 1 year, because first it was adapter, and now it is controller. Yeah, maybe all this factory dependency injections, all this stuff. And also dependency injection, not by string, because if we put some string with error, after that we begin thinking why it doesn't work. But when we do dependency injection with strongly type, it is immediately work or doesn't work, and it says why doesn't work. Maybe yes, maybe it will be a good idea about next presentation. Thank you. And why factory method was here in factory? Because when we do object-oriented programming, we use a lot of methods simultaneously. And we just stressing now one side or another side of this programming or a third one. So we showing this method piece by piece, but in production module, which is not example, which is real production, we use everything together. Thank you, very good question.
Actually, this presentation was initially 5 to 6 hours, because we tried this Drupal model, a Greek model that is automatically trying to do upgrade 7 to 8, and we tried it multiple times, saw different results. Finally, it came that our method works best and is faster, and it gives you understanding of the business logic. That's quite good to do. Even rewriting 7 for 7 is not a waste of time, because after that you will just copy and paste it.
Yeah, and after that it will be the same ability to copy and paste from 8 to 9 in the future.
Yeah, we promise that will be easier.
Yeah.
Did I hear from you, I think, a few weeks ago, during your presentation, that you actually started to, use the word prototype, and started to create your D8 style transitioning, but still using D7?
Yes, okay. Yes. That means, what does it mean D8 here? We have some Drupal 8 shape using Symfony, using all this stuff. This is like, let me return back maybe. Okay. It's gone already. That's why I need, maybe page down. Yes. Yes. Yes, good. That's what I need. Okay, no, vice versa. Vice versa. Yes, here. So this area, like controller form configured, is a standard shape of a Drupal 8 module. And this shape is has been done just for Drupal 8 with Symfony, with all this stuff. But a great background piece of Drupal 8, this is a PSR4 object-oriented inside. So, for making Drupal 7 PSR4 object-oriented, we just install a separate module which allows this. And after that, it is in references to, for example, this DB maintenance and other modules. So we install a separate module. We have PSR4. We have all object-oriented style allowed in Drupal 7. And after that, we start writing in Drupal 7, in Drupal 8 style. So we rewriting. And the advantage of this is that we start from working model. We not starting like from clear table, from nothing. The working model, and we piece by piece gradually shifting it to object-oriented style. When we'll finish it, it is already Drupal 8 style, it is ready to move to Drupal 8 without rewriting. With copy, paste, done.
About a year ago, I got some help from a module called X-Autoload.
Yes, this one. So X-Autoload plus Drupal 7, yes, you are right. Or or inside Drupal 8 we have the same. So X-Autoload, yes.
So your path was fairly clean, and there are too many obstacles once you want to go to the 8.
You know what, we were surprised. There were not too many obstacles, because the path to Drupal 8, it is like two pieces. One piece is Drupal 8 itself. It is shape of Drupal 8 module. And another piece, it is our own module functionality, which we cannot find in Drupal 7 and Drupal 8, because it is ours, so we need to rewrite it. And regular path, it is to rewrite it in the Drupal 8 style. That means mainly to rewrite the whole module. But first, what we do, because it is object-oriented, encapsulation, inheritance, polymorphism. Let us try, for example, first encapsulation. So we encapsulate, we hide in all specific functionality, we put it all into one class. This is like here. Oh, sorry, I need this page down. Yes. We found, for example, all config functionality, all config use case controller. So instead of direct calling config calls, we introduced extra abstraction layer of this config handler, which is controller class. Almost all problem in object-oriented programming could be solved by adding extra abstraction layer, except too many abstraction layers. So here, what we did. The class diagram, the class looks outside the same for Drupal 7 and Drupal 8. We went through the module, we collected all this config functionality, encapsulated it into one class, and made the class interface, that means what is open to external users, and now external user is main work stream of our module. It is the same.
But did you use an interface with our abstract?
It is interesting. As we were talking, there are controllers and controllers, because it is too common word. Here also there are interfaces and interfaces. First interface, it is interface and implementation. Implementation means what inside, interface means all which is outside. And interface as a programming term, yes, it is like later we use this as well. So here it is a programming interface. That's why on this config handler, I was talking interface as not particular this interface, but what is visible to outside consumers of this class. And implementation is what inside and outside consumers doesn't see it. Like the car, we have like steering wheel, brake, like accelerator, gas tap. My wife doesn't know about last one. So so we have like this, but inside it is very complex, but we don't think about this because we use interface but not implementation. So here is the same. We collected all functionality, we encapsulated it into classes which are quite common, and after that we provide just then from Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, and because all functionality is encapsulated, we are done. And somewhere where this functionality is specific for Drupal 7 to Drupal 8, like in config, we encapsulated everything and we had to rewrite. Yes, we had to rewrite, but just one class. And all these pieces, they are common. It is the same, just copy, paste, change name of parameters. We don't need to travel through all modules and collect all there. It is here on one page. And and there, next, it is like here, interface. It is a bit a different meaning of interface, which is interface in programming style, but it also provides interface in like in the first style, like interface implementation, but we do implementation via programming interfaces as well. And because particular object is hidden behind the interface, the mainstream even doesn't know whom is it talking to. And it is very convenient because it is loose coupling. That means that in mainstream, nowhere, we don't have any MySQL or PGSQL specific piece of code. That's why we put, for example, MS SQL or Oracle DB handler, and we just did one class, and we done, we are sure that all mainstream works.
That's good architecture. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.